me out and let me work with you. So as you guys just heard, I've been practicing throat singing for about 9 years. And in that time, I've been able to go to Tuva a couple times. Lived there for 3 months in 2011 and 2013 while doing a master's degree in social anthropology. And I read a whole lot about Tuva, learned a lot about its history, and got to live there for a total of 6 months and watched these throat singers in their day-to-day, hung out with them, got to see what their lives were like. And though I've been singing the music for a very, very long time, of course, the whole journey of learning the music and then learning the context socially, culturally, economically from which it comes certainly has allowed me to really figure out a lot of the nuances of the music, both technically and culturally speaking. So I think I'd like to introduce you tonight to that music, to the culture, in a way that will help prep you for watching the Alosh show a little bit later. So first, I'd like to talk to you about throat singing and what it is. How many of you are familiar with throat singing? All right, so we got about a third. For those of you who haven't ever heard of throat singing before, you heard Ionel on stage earlier, creating something, a sound with his voice that's pretty miraculous, right? It sounded almost like a flute or a whistle. And throat singing is really becoming more and more popular, but I still think that a lot of people out there don't really know how this is possible. So, in throat singing, there are two vocal types. One vocal type that you have to learn to create these incredible sounds is called humé in the Tuvan language. And humé is the name of the style of throat singing, but it's also the name of the overall practice. And humé is a vocal type, you'll hear it a lot when Alosh is performing later tonight. Sounds kind of constricted and tight, and a lot of people often ask whether or not this is damaging to the vocal cords or if it hurts at all when you're singing this way, and definitely not. It's just a completely different way of using the vocal anatomy to create a specific sound that Tuvans aesthetically really enjoy. But when you're learning to sing this style, you're not just learning to produce the kind of bass note that humé creates, this really tight, constricted sound. You're also learning to modulate the vocal track in such a way that overtones already naturally present in the fundamental pitch of your voice resonate and sound almost like a flute being played, right? So it sounds as though you're creating two different notes at one time. But what's really going on is that Tuvans have figured out how to, again, modulate their vocal tracks such that you hear what sounds like two notes simultaneously. So to begin with, I'm going to demonstrate this for you and show you that not just Tuvans can do this, right? Americans can as well. But also it's worth noting, culturally, a lot of Tuvans will tell you when you're learning throat singing that all these different styles, humé and the other vocal type we'll get to in a second, kargida, are these kind of sonic metaphors for landscape. So when you hear this style, certainly keep in mind the intricate technicalities that are going on vocally when these singers perform, but also remember that this is a way for them to metaphorize home. You know, a lot of them will say that the sounds of throat singing remind them of creeks or maybe wind in the trees. And I think that might help to help you form a kind of mental landscape as they perform in a moment. But, how about listening to some humé?
Oh.
Was everyone able to hear those multiple notes occurring simultaneously? Pretty cool. So the next style of throat singing, this kind of second vocal type that I mentioned in the very beginning, we just heard Kume, and there's a second type that you learn when you begin throat singing called Kargira. And Kargira is unique amongst all throat singing styles in as much as you actually do sing from a different sound source in the throat. You're not just using your vocal cords, you're using a second series of folds and muscles called the ventricular folds. And if you get them to engage, they actually vibrate exactly half the speed of the vocal cords. So you can sing a note an entire register lower than your, or octave lower rather, than your normal register. So you're going to hear some guys later, when Awash performs, singing these incredibly deep bass notes. And when they're singing these notes, they're singing, again, from a totally different part of the vocal anatomy. Now, culturally in tuba, whenever you're learning this particular style, Kargira, the second bass style, a lot of singers will tell you that you really need to feel as though you're in the mountains. But this is a kind of style that might call to mind looking at a mountain range from somewhere in the steppe lands. You've got this really broad bass sound that you'll hear in just a moment when I perform. But over the top, you'll also hear this kind of whistling melody, but the melody isn't as prominent as in the style you just heard Hume. It's a kind of background, soft, subtle sound. And for tubans, this recalls like the pitches and slopes of mountain ranges that are offset by like a setting sun. Just very romantic imagery, right? But quite a beautiful style, and certainly worth keeping that imagery in mind when you hear it. So, this is the style Kargira. How dare you? Technology penetrating into my show. All right, Kargira. Sub-techniques or additional techniques that you can use to modulate these fundamental pitches I just demonstrated. So for instance, there's a technique you can apply to that first vocal type, Hume, and this technique is called Sagut. And Sagut in Tuvan means the whistling sound, and it produces... So this sub-technique, Sagut, allows you to sing Hume, that first style I presented to you guys, but produce this really, really high-pitched whistling sound, which is what Ayanol was doing when he was out here on stage. So I'm going to demonstrate that to you. But culturally, a lot of tubans will say when you're learning this style, Sagut, that you should keep in mind the Song of Birds, right? It's a very high-pitched whistle with a very muted and diminished fundamentally. So it's a bit. Take the time to explain a lot of these techniques, not to completely demystify everything Awash will be doing on stage in a little bit, but more to help you gain a better understanding of the difficulty of all of these techniques. But throat singing, though you can sing it solo like this, is primarily sung along with instruments. So I'm going to ask my friend Badi Dorju from the Awash Ensemble to come out and play a tuba instrument with me. So to begin, Body's going to demonstrate for you this instrument. It's a tuba instrument called the gil. And into its highly respected, very beautiful instrument, kind of like we might look at a cello, a bit classical. Thank you again for having me. It's really great to be in Baltimore.